What made you want to make a film about the magnificent Ralph Steadman?
I'd say that the reason for the film would be my complete adoration of his work. And I've always been a fan from being an art student. So the chance of working with Ralph was an opportunity, if I was given it, I would jump at. I sent Ralph a letter, I'd say 15 years ago, that asked Ralph to look at some work I'd done with a previous artist that I'd been working with, a guy called Peter Howson. Ralph saw the piece of film that I'd shot and thought it was great, but said that if I wanted to come down and talk to him about it, that'd be fine. I went down to Loose Court, where Ralph lives, and I made myself indispensable as far as being around the studio is concerned, and from then on it just blossomed into an ongoing relationship. One of the first things that we did, which was a fantastic stroke of luck, was that Ralph always has a camera above his drawing desk taking pictures of what he does as he works, and this is a process that I'd worked in before as well. So the first thing we did was set up a digital camera above his desk, and Ralph, whenever he drew, would take pictures of what he's drawing. And so I had the opportunity each week or each month to go down and take the chip out of the camera, replace it with a new chip, come back to my studio with this work and look at what Ralph had done in the previous month. And that was fantastic. That was me opening up all this new art every month. And from that, I had the opportunity to come back down and ask questions about what he was doing. And it took about 10 years of us fiddling around like that. We came to a point where we felt that we had the beginning of a story. That again changed a great deal in the last 5 years, but that was the beginning of the whole thing. The film has been entirely led by Ralph, so the reason it took a long time to make was because we filmed, Ralph talked, and I think from you notice Ralph will go in many directions in a conversation, so it was very much a matter of picking up these pieces and re-feeding them back into the plot. So the film has a really personal feel about it because it actually is driven entirely about by Ralph's interests and stories that Ralph finds important. So it's unscripted and it's collected from years of observations. And so you get this feeling of very much being one-to-one with Ralph in his studio. And you kind of get that feeling from Johnny and Ralph's relationship within the film, that you're there learning about things that Ralph's interested in.
Johnny Depp had such a special connection with Hunter and Ralph's work. How did he become involved in this particular project, and why do you think it was important to have him present and talking with Ralph?
We always needed someone to bounce off Ralph in the studio, and we wanted to have the feeling of the viewer being with Ralph and in the conversation. So Johnny was always a candidate for that. Johnny loves Ralph, always has done. Johnny's love of Hunter and of Gonzo was a driving force for Johnny's interest. Johnny was been with the project ever since we started actually cutting footage together, but we, in the end, decided that it was a story of Johnny and Ralph's weekend together. And so we were feeding Johnny stories and Johnny was responding to them. Johnny's incredibly knowledgeable about the whole of Gonzo and Ralph and Hunter. So he brought a lot to the project himself that he already had as far as back stories of Hunter's or stuff he'd read or pictures he'd seen of Ralph's. So Johnny was very much part of the whole process throughout, to be perfectly honest. It shows in the film. He's very relaxed and the two of them have a great rapport. So I think that helps the movie kind of just effortlessly move along in its kind of like sweet little way.
There are a lot of artists that excel in the medium, but I think there are a surprisingly rare few who are capable of claiming that they've invented a new one. You mentioned Gonzo. I think clearly it's a word that everyone associates with Ralph and with Hunter. What do you think defines the essence of that, and why do you think it is such an important landmark in the art and literature of the 20th century?
I think what Hunter did and Ralph did at the time was unprecedented. So it was new and fresh. I think they both pursued their goals with little regard for what was around them. I think that's something that's an incredibly valuable lesson to learn these days. We're very conscious of doing things correctly, not upsetting too many people. Those guys, they wandered around doing whatever they want, and that shows a kind of a braveness and an interest in their subjects that that kind of superseded the general opinion of the time. So both Ralph and Unhunter, in a way, created work that that was two fingers up to everything around them, and I think everyone appreciated it. I certainly did. That was the reason I was attracted to them in the first place as an art student. I thought it was just amazing that people were writing and drawing like this in a time when everyone was struggling to find their voice, really. So I think they succeeded. I think time shows now that they managed to create something new in a time when that wasn't available to other people. And it's amazing work. I think it holds up to time. And you can look at the drawings and the writing, and it's as fresh now as it was then, really.
In the mythology of Gonzo, there's this idea that Hunter was the mad one and everyone else was just dragged along for the ride. But I think one of the things that the film very clearly explores is the idea that in some ways Ralph was almost even braver than Hunter in terms of how far he would go, particularly when it came to the subject of America.
That was certainly the case. I would say that Hunter quite often pushed people like Ralph in front of him to bounce off and to say what he wanted to say, even though he often was shy of saying it himself. I would say the good thing of what Ralph had going for him was that he was an Englishman abroad, and he felt he could say whatever he wants. And Ralph certainly said what he wanted about America at the time. And as Jan says in the film, in that period of time, I think Ralph was being braver than anyone around him by drawing stuff that people wouldn't say. And Hunter certainly was more aware of his position in America than Ralph was. So it allowed Ralph the freedom to say the things he said. And we look at them now as being incredibly brave and reckless, to be perfectly honest. And so I agree with Jan. I think at the time, Ralph was braver than anyone around him. And you can certainly see that in some of the drawings that he made at that period.
How much of an impact on the world do you think that Ralph's work specifically has had?
It's difficult to change history or change the path of things. I think everyone has a small part, an incremental part in the bigger picture. I know for a fact that Ralph has changed the life of people like me, and therefore in the work that I do, which is influenced by Ralph, that change is happening throughout time. As an individual, it's difficult to pin any particular change to them, but I certainly feel that that period of Gonzo and of American history has certainly been flavoured and described by people that have changed our perception about that time. So I would say that they have changed the world in a small part, and it is up to us to view those changes and take them on. Terry has a lovely quote in the film about protesting and feeling as if that your protests are forgotten. But I would say Terry Gilliam, Ralph, Hunter, William Burroughs have all contributed to where we are now. And it is, even though Ralph denies it's a better place, I think the planet is a better place for the work they've done.
Can you talk a little bit about some of the extraordinary musical performers that got involved and how easy it was to bring them into Ralph's mad world?
Absolutely. We have a fantastic musical lineup of the film. People like Slash, Jason Mraz, the All-American Rejects, Linville Golding from The Specials, they all contributed fantastic tracks to the film, purely because their love of Ralph and his history. Ed Hardcourt, who does a fantastic track in the War Files part, is a complete fan of Ralph's and was so willing to participate. Slash, again, Ralph has worked with Slash in the past, but Slash came out with a fantastic piece of music that he really wanted to be part of the film. So we've been really privileged to have at least 10 recording artists create fantastic, unique pieces for the film and for their love of Ralph. And even though Ralph's influence has been artistic and literal, his influence on musicians around the world has been incredible. And it's been a fantastic privilege to have these great musical artists all contribute. We have Slash in London, I think, next week, who's threatening to come find Ralph at the end of the film. And it's great to think this new generation of people are kind of carrying this mantle still, this message. And the fact it's come across so many different mediums has made this film very strong, and not only literally, but visually and now audibly. So it's been great, and it's been a privilege working with these fantastic people. Interestingly, that when we started this project, Ralph had never had anything animated of his work before, mainly because he'd always refused the idea of it, because Ralph always felt that his stuff was still images that didn't really justify being reinvented in movement. Ralph has always described his art as being like a fly hitting a windscreen of a car. It's that moment the fly hits the windscreen, the splat, is the moment that his drawings exist in. And we took that as an idea, and so all the animations within the film lead up to the drawing. We never take them past the drawing. So you might notice that all the animations take us to the moment the picture is, and then we stop there, and that is the picture that you have in your mind. So working backwards from each drawing, we managed to invent the pre-story, but we never took it further than the actual drawing itself. And Ralph liked that. He found that it was true to the intention of the original art, and yet it gave it a dimension in space and time that allowed it to become something good for films. And it's very hard making a film with just art, so we use quite a few different techniques, like motion control and animation, to bring texture to the medium of film. But essentially the film is about Ralph's art, and we took great pains never to leave the art in a new place. And Ralph likes that. He's very proud of the animation, and I'm very proud that he's allowed us to do it. And I'm very happy that that this is the first time this stuff's been animated, and it's been animated to a kind of a degree that Ralph will stand by. So yeah, we're very pleased with the animation. It was all created in-house by a fantastic animator, Kevin Richards, who basically learnt Ralph's pen and worked in it beautifully. So we're very proud of that stuff. To be perfectly honest, I think the original work in Fear and Loathing had the most influence on me. I found that work so liberating as an artist of the time. So I would say that those drawings, even though they're some of the simplest and most naive of Ralph's art, have a very special place in my heart. But I think Ralph's art developed in a way that that encouraged me and took me along as an art student in a way that was always surprising. So the work in the Leonardo suite for I, Leonardo, and the work he did for the Freud book, and I think one of his most incredible achievements was a book called The Big I Am, about God and the creation of the planet. I watched that work develop over the years, and to me they are the most beautiful work that Ralph created, and the most complete pieces. So I would say that between the early drawings of Ralph's and the later paintings of Ralph, those two areas are of my greater interest in a way, and I love that stuff. Ralph has always been associated with Hunter, quite rightfully. Their partnership through the years has been a very strong one. From the outset of this film, Ralph was my subject, and he was the reason I made the film. And so throughout the entire process of making the film, we very much had to keep a lid on Hunter, as you can imagine. Hunter, in many cases, spilled over and took the story away. And even with Johnny, we were very careful to make sure, because Johnny's relationship with Hunter was very strong as well, we made sure that all roads led back to Ralph. We could have made a lot more of Hunter and tried to make the film popular through the kind of gonzo kind of medium, but this film is about Ralph, and Hunter is a by story to Ralph's life in a way, And so I think we did well, I think, to contain Hunter and Johnny within Ralph's story and make this film about Ralph was one of the greatest challenges, and I think we managed to do that quite successfully. So even though obviously Hunter comes in halfway through the film and is the end of the film as far as the loss of Hunter's concerned, I think we can have got a healthy balance between Ralph's relationship with Hunter and his art being obviously in many different guises apart from just work with Hunter. So the fact that we do talk about New York and Leonardo and all his other projects, I think, is very important for the film. And Hunter's a hard person to keep under. He's bubbles up the whole time, appears in every story, and we were quite selective really as to how we used him.
What are you hoping audiences take away, ranging from people who love Ralph's work to people who've maybe never heard of it before, those miserable bastards?
Yeah. I made this film to tell the story of Ralph because of my kind of love of Ralph's work. If you've never heard of Ralph and you see this film, or you have done, and this film illuminates a new story about Ralph, I'm hoping that that the appreciation of Ralph's art is one strand, but Ralph's outlook on life and his efforts to do better for everybody is the inspirational part of the film. And I think if people came out of the film feeling inspired to, in whatever medium, try and express, like Ralph has, one's, not necessarily outrage, but one's interest in the world outside, then that would be for me, a successful film. And I think the film does feel inspiration. I think people come out from the film and they feel like they want to go and do something. And that is, I think, the strongest thing, really, that I hope they leave with at the end. The greatest thing for me has been spending 15 years with Ralph. That's been, obviously, it's been fantastic. And that's why it took 15 years to make. There was no reason to not be with Ralph. I do think at the end of it all, I think that looking back on the film, as a filmmaker, I think my biggest achievement is capturing Ralph as he really is. I think it took a long time to allow the film to discover Ralph as the real person, and I think it does. I think it's a good record of a real man, and he is like the man in the film. I'm very proud of that. When I watch the film, we're not pretending he's something he's not. He is the man you see in the film. And I think generally everyone feels when they see the film what a lovely man he is. And he is. It's been an absolute pleasure spending that time with him.
Is there anything you're particularly sad you weren't able to cram in? And would you ever be interested in exploring using some of the material you've gathered to extend the Ralph story?
I think some of the reasons some of the stuff didn't make it in was it didn't actually tell the Ralph story. So interviews with Bruce Robinson were fantastic. Interview with Tim Robbins came down to the house and we filmed with him down there. That never made it into the film. There are certain books that we investigated, like his book on dogs or on Freud, which never made it through as well. But I would say that everything that hit the cutting room floor did so justifiably, in so much as the film is a linear story. You can hear Ralph in the background, screaming away in the background there. So I think everything that did hit the floor, the cutting room floor, just did so justifiably. But I would say interviews with Tim Robbins, Bruce Robinson, all these fantastic characters were inspirational in themselves and sadly didn't make the film. And yes, you never know, there could be a part two. Yes.